correct line. This session is Living, Breathing Drupal, the Biology of the Request. My name is Kenny, webkenny on z.o. I work for Acquia. We're the enterprise guide to Drupal, so we provide support and professional services related to Drupal, as well as training and a great partner program. So if you own a development shop and you're interested in becoming a partner, come see me after the session. There's my obligatory pitch. So today we're going to talk about, well, first of all, if you have a mobile phone and you're going to tweet, the hashtag for this session is DCL Safari. So today we're going to talk about basically how Drupal works end-to-end. When Drupal makes a request from the time the request is received to the end of the request. And it's actually showing the page. So first let's talk about Drupal as a system. And like many systems, it's built on traditional design patterns. Design patterns, they're everywhere in this platform. And so if we really understand the patterns, then we can really learn how Drupal works. One of the patterns that Drupal is based on, thank you, Larry Gaffield, for your great blog post on this, is observer and visitor. And like Drupal's hook system, subjects contain objects called observers that listen and respond to events. And visitor builds on the idea that objects can be extended. So very much like the hooks in Drupal. In Drupal 7's new database layer, you can find the patterns of factory command objects. There are several variations on the factory pattern, but they all boil down to the same idea. One object, a client, asks another object, the factory, for an appropriate implementation of a piece of logic. It doesn't care which it is. In the command pattern, the process of, quote, doing something, is wrapped up in an object. We create a new instance of the object, configure it, execute it, and then cause the action to take place. The dependency injection pattern is where things are sent to the object rather than requesting it on its own. Think of the variables passed into most Drupal functions by reference, right? That little and sign in front of every variable and function. What's funny? What if we don't know in advance what dependent information or context we will need, or if it will vary? One common solution is a variant of the concept of something called broker and migration. I don't know. This doesn't feel like it's working. Does this feel like it's working to you? There has to be a better way to explain this. I am serious, and don't call me further. Oh yeah, I went there. All right, let's reboot. You guys ready to have some fun? Let's have some fun. First, let's meet the request. Ladies and gentlemen, 8-bit dreams. A round of applause for 8-bit dreams. Dreams is going to take us through a magical journey through Drupal today. We're going to go end-to-end through the overworld of Drupal, and we're going to learn all about how it works. And we're going to leave all that boring design pattern stuff where it belongs on the first 4 slides. All right. So I present to you the legend of Drupal. I know you recognize this theme music. Oh, I know you do. All right, so when Drupal starts off, we start off at something called the bootstrap. All right, so when Drupal first takes a request from a web server, it has to bootstrap. And really, that's just a fancy way of saying that it has to load the minimum requirements that it's going to require to serve what you've asked for. So the bootstrap is a special file called bootstrap.include. You can find it in the includes folder. I highly recommend that if you're really interested in the underpinnings of Drupal, that you go into that file and take a look. I mean, that's how I wrote most of the session on it. So. And it's broken into 7 distinct phases. Now, I'm going to do a little disclaimer here because I'm going to go through these phases in the way that they are laid out. However, you should know that if you really want to know how this works, they sort of bounce between them. Like the database phase happens later in the request, earlier in the request, but I'm going to go with the 7 that I know more. All right? So first is the configuration phase. So just like the Legend of Drupal or any of your famous video games, you always start off by entering your name. That's a variable. So it's an important variable to our request. And basically what the configuration phase of the bootstrap does is it has custom error handling, it's prepared, settings PHP file that you've defined gets loaded, and some PHP variables are modified. So those are those little in sets that you see in, you know, when you're setting your memory limit and things of that nature. And then key variables that are used later in the request are initialized. So that's configuration. Now, phase two is the page cache phase. In Drupal, there are two of these. There's an early page cache and a late page cache. For now, all you really have to understand is that if it finds the page that you're requesting in cache, it will return it, and the execution of the request will end. So to give you a little bit of an idea of the difference between early and late, basically, early means that it's, you know, early on in the bootstrap, and late means exactly what you think it's later on in the bootstrap. And the real distinction between those is that later on in the bootstrap, a function called hook boot, early in the bootstrap, a function called hook boot doesn't run. That's what you have to know about that. So that's when you click that aggressive setting in your performance page and complains and says XYZ module is not going to be compatible. That's why. So just like most video games, if we've already saved this game at the end, there's no reason to continue. We just select it and move forward. Next is the Drupal database phase. It connects to your database, it loads the appropriate database include file you've assigned, and it basically, you know, makes a connection to it. And this way it can do its queries and, you know, because everything in Drupal is the database, right? And so, however, though, if for some reason your database isn't available and it fails, like if this were your Nintendo in 1988 and the database failed, it might look something like this. So, luckily, Drupal provides a much nicer fight offline message, and you also don't have to blow into the cartridge and use a Q-tip on it to get it to work. Now, before we move on, let's see where we're going. Many years ago, the evil Prince Darkness Kitten stole one of the Tri-Core with power, the Golden Hook. Princess Drupal had one of the Tri-Core with wisdom. She traveled to the end of the island to hide it from Kitten before she was captured by his evil army. Go find the crystal node, please, to save her. So our entire journey today is going to be based around finding the crystal node. There's our hero, ready in the overworld. All right. So, here we go. The next phase of the bootstrap is the variables phase. This is where Drupal initializes its locking mechanism. It loads its variables. It checks the cache along the way to see if it can save any time by loading those variables. And the last thing that Drupal does before it calls the bootstrap function is it resets the variables that came from your settings PHP file. So, very much like the inventory in an RPG game, this is where everything is essentially loaded. Right, these are all the things that you're going to carry with you throughout this request. And of course, everyone in here knows Priest, and you know he doesn't go anywhere without a job. Next is the page header phase. This is where hook boot is called for all the participating modules. And if Drupal's not on the command line, like Drush, for example, an HTTP header is set. Alright, and this, you know, this is the thing. I mean, when you really get into Drupal, if you really want to see how it works, you just got to look at the code. And really, you know, when you hear page header phase, that sounds really fancy. But really, it's just that function right there. And how many lines of code is that? 6? So essentially, all it's really doing is just, like I said, it's bootstrap invoke all, which we'll talk about a little bit later. We'll talk about invoke all. But that calls all of your hook boots. Every time you see invoke all, you can basically add hook to the beginning of whatever the word is next to it, and that's what's going to happen. And then, of course, like I said, it goes on the command line. It'll assign the command line. It sends a page header. All right, so next up is the session phase. All right, this is where Drupal determines if the request is a logged-in user or not. And remember, when you're logged in, there's never going to be a cached page. But, you know, one thing to remember as a little sidebar is that that only applies to your page cache, right? That can be frustrating. Sometimes you're logged in as an administrator, your menus aren't updating, your variables aren't updating, you don't understand because you're logged in. Well, that really only applies to page cache. Every other caching mechanism in Drupal doesn't respect that. So you literally have to clear your cache to see all the fresh information. The next phase is the language phase. This is where the translation of Drupal's interface takes place. You know, this is where the key function that you define, if you're a great programmer on all of your modules, this is where all that happens. And, you know, one of the things is that Drupal has hundreds of translations that are available for it, and that's on localized.drupal.org. And that's the phase where we basically rewrite the language of the entire interface. after he's been taught a new magic language. And now, he's going to get rid of the mage. Because Greece is ruthless. All right. Heading into the cave. Trust me, this was very fun to do. Okay. Comes out the other side. Excellent. And our next phase, we're going to talk, well, the next thing we're going to talk about, that's seven phases of the bootstrap. So the next thing we're going to talk about is the mini system and how that works. The next thing that actually occurs after Drupal bootstraps is we have to know, essentially, where it's going to go. Right? And so the question about the menu system is, well, how does it know where to go? You know, when you request /bar, how does it know what /bar is? And so when a request comes in, assuming that you have, you know, assuming that you have the path module enabled, which allows you to add aliases, it basically looks up the path alias as its regular, you know, node /45. And then it goes to a table called menu router. And inside the menu router table of Drupal is essentially every defined path that is in the system. And that can be a very big table. And that's also a really great way to, when you're having menu problems, is to dump the contents of that table and then visit your module page and it will all be rebuilt. That's where that actually takes place. So the menu system is, you know, broken down into a lot of different ways. And I mean, how is Dries going to know where to go on this big island? Well, according to our buddy Link, you should just press the left for the map. So the first question is, where are we going? You know, where are we going in Drupal? And, you know, this is, what you're seeing here below is, that is the code that essentially tells Drupal, when you hook menu, where it should go. And you're passing an items array, and, you know, that, the castle could be any path at all. It could have slashes in it, it could have arguments in it, it can have anything in it. And that gets written to the menu router table. And so this is where it determines where we're headed. And the next question we're going to logically ask is, you know, can we get there? Yeah, I mean, you know, are we going to be able to actually to get there? Do we have the right keys? Are we, you know? And that really is broken down to a function called the access callback. It's just a property of your array. And inside the array, it's just, you know, it, you can put anything there, actually. You could put true if it was one of those things that you didn't care if anybody had access to. Most people will use user access or some other access callback to do some complicated logic. But this is essentially what determines whether or not you can access the path. If so, you proceed. If not, execution stops and you get a 403. And now the last question is, how do we get there? Right? So how do we actually travel from where we are now in the R of Drupal all the way to the castle on the L? And what takes place between UP and A essentially is the what's called the page callback. That's a function that you define that just tells Drupal what it should do when it finds that path. And that's how Drupal decides how it's going to render the page. And somewhere in Drupal, a function is defined for every single path. Even if it's a node path, a custom path, there is always something like this somewhere. All right. Our next stop is onto the hook system. My favorite piece of Drupal, because when I really got this, I really was able to sort of graduate into a Drupal expert. You know, it's one of those things that you go along building sites, you kind of understand hooks, you really don't. Once you really understand how they work, you really can leverage the power, and that's what we're going to talk about now. Just going across the bridge. A lot of animation, bear with me. So, the hook system of Drupal, you know, you'll recall earlier, if you were awake when I said this, that I referred to something called dependency injection at the start of the session. And that's basically, this is a variant of that design pattern. What it means is that as Drupal goes through its defined hooks and it executes each one, it inserts or injects the variables that it finds in what's being passed to the function. Right? So that's that little ampersand dollar sign foo variable that's in, you know, any one of the hooks out there. So for example, in hook node view, there is a node object that gets passed in. And that can be added to it. And so how does Drupal determine which one it's going to call first? Well, it basically does it in two ways. It determines by the weight of the actual module, which is defined in a magic table called system. I highly recommend you learn it. It's a great new table in Drupal. And that basically has the weight. That's the very first thing. And so weight is just simply an integer. It can be anywhere from -99 to +99. And so first it orders it by that. And then if something has the same weight, like if everything has 0, like it usually does when you install Drupal, it goes in alphabetical order, in an alpha state. So, you know, Apple module executes first, and Zebra module executes last. So very much like an inventory in our game, as variables are passed by reference, they're added to. So, you know, for example, the form variable and form alter. In this case, Reese has picked up a field, and now it is part of the hook. All right. Next, into the forest. And so, you know, hooks, they don't just add. Sometimes, you know, we use hooks to take things away from something. So in a hook form alter, we might unset five or six form variables because we don't want that to show up. So hooks can basically modify. It's a nice way to think of it. It can delete, it can add, it can, you know, twist, bend, whatever. That's sort of what all hooks. And, you know, if we want to remove things, we can do that too. Major bonus points if you can tell me what game that is from after the second. And I might even get to you a couple of free death point accounts. All right, so let's talk about this function. This is basically module invoke all. As far as I'm concerned, this is one of the best functions in Drupal. Because to me, I mean, Drupal documentation is excellent, right? The API is 100% complete because there's a doctrine sort of code formatting standard to it, and that's how it's generated. Unfortunately, what isn't always greatly documented? Contributed modules, right? Sometimes it's really difficult to figure out what hooks you're allowed to tap into in a module. Well, really, this is the magic function that does it all. I mean, if you're having trouble finding out what hooks you can use in a contributed module, a simple search using Drupal or any one of your favorite text editor tools can, of the modules folder, return this. So if you're looking for module invoke all and you find like 15 instances of it in the OGU folder, then that's every hook that is defined by organic groups. So it's a really useful way to be able to sort of go through and you know, understand what each module has to offer that you can modify. And again, you know, this is one of those situations where the code really isn't all that big of a deal. You know, I mean, the only function here that might seem a little scary is that call user func array. It's really not that big of a deal. It just means that it can pass any arguments, any variables at all to this function, and it'll just pick them up by name. It's just PHP's way of doing that. All right, now, last but not least, the theme system of Drupal comes into focus. This is where all the presentation decisions of Drupal are made. So assuming that you have, you know, built the correct, you know, or like not necessarily correct, but built a site with best practices, you're going to separate presentation from logic. So all of your presentations should be taking place from this point on. I think that was more for me. Look, it's the Drupal 7 core maintainer, Angie Webchick-Byron. She's here to teach our hero about the theme system. All right, so again, the theming system is the presentation layer. First, let's talk about the theme loading process. Right? So when Drupal gets the request and goes through all of its, you know, all of its hooks and everything else, it has to determine what theme to load. Is it going to be Darwin? Is it going to be Bartik? Is it going to be some custom theme? And what that essentially allows Drupal to do is then be able to know what folder it has to look in for the files like template.php and the TPL files. So that all happens in the loading process. Now, obviously, I'm abridging what occurs in these, and I highly recommend you sort of go and find that. And this is in a file called theme include. And so the next thing is after it's found the theme, it's going to load up template.php and execute what are called pre-process functions inside it. So just like hooks, if you remember, they follow a certain naming convention, you know, hook formal, hook node view. And there are the same sort of naming conventions for Drupal theme. Okay, so it's essentially, you know, just to think of one off the top of my head, pre-process node is one. And that means that every time a node is rendered, that function is called. And in the front of the word pre-process, you can put your theme name, right? So if I take pre-process nodes, for example. And things are just like the hook system. This is almost this is exactly the same thing. You can add things to it, you can take them away, you can bend, twist, and shift, that sort of thing. The last thing that Drupal does is it then loads your page template files using its suggestion engine, right? And any theme functions or hooks that you may define tell it where to find its various theme functions. And along with that, it loads the JavaScript, the CSS, the images, anything else that comes into the browser. And that's not really technically part of the Drupal sort of request cycle, right? Because that set gets loaded and then your browser requests it. So that's not really Drupal overhead going out to do that, which is why you see things out there like web page optimizer, you know, that sort of talks about how to optimize the front page, and that's why compressing CSS and JS is so important, because Drupal really doesn't have any control over that. And so now, after the request, we've arrived at the castle where the principal node is, and our hero has basically, you know, for lack of a better word, completed his journey. And he's ready to present himself to the evil kitten and find the crystal node. I don't know about you, but I grew up hearing that the princess was in the castle. And that was what they're doing. So anyway, we're at the end of our quest, and so this next part of the session I'm going to kind of divert a little bit, and I'm going to talk a little bit about how you can use this information to build that quest. And it's going to be a pretty lively Q&A, so if you guys are, you know, want to ask questions, I'd like to have that. If you were at my last session, you know, I'd like to have long Q&As. Of course, the obligatory game over screen. You know, this is actually an important topic. Let's talk about the update system. So there is a sort of a side piece of analysis, a very important piece of Drupal, but it's a side file you have to actually execute. It's called update.php. So when you request a page, right, it's coming from index.php. And when you install Drupal, it's going to install PHP. Pretty easy. When you want to do database updates, you visit something called update.php or you use Drush and run a command called Drush.updb. It all does basically the same thing. And what it does is that it essentially goes to my favorite table in Drupal that I've talked about, which is the system table, okay? The system table, it essentially contains things like name, it contains file path, it contains the weight that I talked about, but it also contains a pretty important number that a lot of people are confused about when they first see it. It's called schema, all right? That's the column. And so the schema number in that table matches up to an update function that you have somewhere or that Drupal has somewhere in its .install files. Let me give you an example. Let's say I have a module called foo, and the schema version in that, when I install, is 1. Now, if I want to update, all I have to do is in .install put foo update 2. And when Drupal runs update.php, it's going to know that it has to increment, and it's going to run that. And so then I can, and so a good way to sort of do quick and dirty testing when you're doing this kind of thing is to go into the system table and just edit the schema role. And let's say you, on a development environment, of course, but let's say you basically run a bad update, right? And it just, you're back to the database, but it doesn't do what you want. It doesn't break anything, it doesn't do what you want. So how do you get to go back and rewrite another update? Well, that gets long when you're debugging. Not really. You just have to go into the schema table, decrement the number by 1, and run a PHP again. So the truth is, you know, the question is, what does all this matter? Right? I mean, so what? I mean, why do you have to know how Drupal works from end to end? It's really important, you know, to a couple of the methods you can use to, like I'll tell you, when I built this session, and one of the ways I did this was I just loaded up my IDE, and I started with the debugger. There's tons of blog posts out there on how to do that. And I basically just stepped line by line through Drupal. You know, and sure, it took me 3 or 4 hours to do that. You know, it was a long time. Now, I didn't go through every single line of code that would have taken forever. But it's good to go through the general form. It's really a good idea to see. I mean, even if you just open up index.php, there's a wealth of information there in terms of what it's doing. You know, it goes through the menu system. It goes through the theming system. I mean, Drupal is big and scary until you realize that it all boils down to one file that just calls all the various functions in the system. That's really all it is. And so it's important to kind of know it end to end, because in many ways there is, you know, there's sort of a troubleshooting edge that you gain, right? When you, so for example, you have a problem on site, client reports a problem to you. They say, you know what? For some reason, the variable on this page is printing out weird PHP errors. Okay. And so you look in the modules, you look in the theme first, so it's showing up, right? So you go look in the theme, you're looking everywhere, you can't find anything that works. Knowing that the theme is loaded last, what would be a really good troubleshooting step? Change the theme, right? Change it to Bartlett, change it to Garmin, change it to one of the default themes. And see if the problem still occurs. And if it does, then there's a problem higher up the stack. Right? And then it's modules.
Now you locate the module that may be causing the problem and the hook that might be causing the problem. What if you still can't locate it? What if you still can't find any of your custom modules? What's happening? Well, what's the next thing? Disable the module, right? Go back, look again, problem's still there. Now you go higher up the request. Sounds like if you're going higher up the request and you disabled a custom module, that is a core bug you should be reporting. And if you disable the core module and it's still, you know, and it's still happening, then it's something in the actual core file that you should be reporting. So by understanding kind of the execution order of Drupal and how it runs from end to end, you can essentially troubleshoot any problem. That also helps you build better sites. Okay? When you understand how Drupal functions, you can build a better site because you know that the theme layer all of your presentations should be. And how many folks in here are 2 years plus Drupal experience? Okay. And so you've seen a lot of sites. How many folks have actually picked up a site from another developer and then had to work on it? Right? And how many of you have seen things in the theme that make you cry? So it's because those developers really haven't, you know, they really didn't understand Drupal at its deepest level to understand that, you know, you really shouldn't be putting a database query in a template because that's not where it belongs. I know that sounds foolish, but that's so funny. So what I'd like to do, like I did at my last session, is I would like to kind of open the floor. This is a really complex topic, so I'd like to open the floor to you for any questions that you have. Do you have a mic for questions, or I think it's going to screen it up? Screen it up. Go ahead. Absolutely, yeah. So in the Bootstrap file, thank you for reminding me, there are a series of constants in there. Yes, thank you, Heather. Thank you, learning services person who teaches me how to do these presentations better. The question was, can you talk a little bit about the constants in the Bootstrap file? So some of these constants that are in the Bootstrap, like Drupal database and Drupal Bootstrap and whatnot. So those constants will map to certain environmental variables. One of those constants would be the CLI function I talked about. If you follow the thread of that CLI function, you'll see a constant called the Drupal CLI. So those constants are toggled at different times. And one of the other constants might be, well, here's an important one. When Drupal bootstraps, not every single module in Drupal bootstraps, which you can tell if you go into the system table, you'll see another column called bootstrap 1.0. And if bootstrap 1 is set, then early on, if you remember when we were going through our inventory in the variable space, early on, it basically sets a constant saying you can run this during the bootstrap. And so then 2 phases later, after it makes it connected to its database, it then runs it. That's the constant that's going to sort of determine the path for bootstrap. Anyone else? Maybe I won't come across one of your sites that has database queries in the thing. So, how many folks in here came from a previous course? Let me repeat the question. First of all, can you give examples in the three different APIs I talked about? The hook API, the theme API, the two, right? Right. In the theme API and module API, where do things go? Right? How do you know when things should go in a certain place? I mean, a lot of that's going to be personal style in terms of whether you're going to put theming up there, but how many folks in here have come from a previous programming language before Drupal? Some kind of a framework. And so you're familiar with this concept of separating business logic from presentation, right? That was deep into our heads for a lot of programmers. And so, good examples in Drupal. Well, here's an interesting thing. All the theme functions that are available in the theming layer, they're also available slightly higher up the stack at the module. There is a matching pre-processed node function at every module level. So you could basically, if you had a module called foo, you'd be able to do foo pre-processed node. And if you had a theme like Bartek, further down the stack, you'd be able to do Bartek pre-processed node. So the question that I often had, like in my head when I was doing this, was how do I know, you know, when it's right to do either or? My sort of, you know, it's kind of a best practice thing, but my hard and fast rule is that, you know, if I need to have something showing up I need to have control over the theming presentation of something, you know, that when the developer gets it, it's at least pre-packaged. So a great example of that actually would be the 5-star module. Anybody use the 5-star module? That does a lot of really interesting theming things in its module files, because it has to, basically present the mock-up for a 5-star. It wouldn't be enough for it to just fit out the values. So that's a great, you know, example of when you would put some theming logic up there in the module stack. But what does that allow you to do by putting it up there instead of, like, burying it in a core theme? Is that it essentially allows the next developer to come around and turn it from 5-star into 5-hour. The next piece I'll talk a little bit about is that anything that talks to your database, do it in the module. That's do it in the module. It's just the best way to probably handle it. Once in a great while, you'll put it in template PHP for whatever reason. But you really should. You really should do it in the module. Any other questions? Absolutely. So there's basically a series of menu hooks in Drupal, and it's, you know, hook menu, so we're hooked with the name of the module, and inside that is just a very simple, right, because it's the array API, is what we call it in Drupal. So inside that is just an array. And each one of those arrays maps to a property, like I talked about, access callback, page callback. That brings up a good point, and another use of constants that we talked about with somebody asked, is that the type of menu item could be menu normal item, which means it'll show up in the menu, menu callback, which means it's just a function that gets called and that path gets called, menu local task. Does anybody in here know what menu local task does? Because it's one of those, like, really vague name things. Right, creates a tab. Right, and in order for a tab to actually appear, a tab has to have a path. So if you define, you know, a path called foo/bar, you have to have a foo. So it's essentially just an array of that. And then in the menu.include file in Drupal is where all of that gets called and essentially included. Hold on. No, we're late. Go ahead. Well, because that's the Drupal interface, right? That's the Drupal interface itself. That's like the actual Drupal interface happening in the language phase. See me afterwards, I'll explain that. It's a little more technical than we probably should talk about the title, but definitely it comes in. It can be, right? And that's why, I mean, this isn't a performance session for those of you that signed in subscribe. I know I did one of those, but this is, you know, that is one of the banes of Drupal, right? Is to execute as little hooks as you possibly can. And how do you do that? You do that with caching. There are other ways you can do that too, right? I mean, you could take the pressure off the database and the caching tables by using technologies like memcache. So yeah, there are a lot of hooks in Drupal. There is an awful lot of execution that goes on, and that's why caching is such an important thing. Now, there are two hooks, there's actually three hooks that depending on your settings, will never run. Hook boot and hook exit, if you have aggressive set in your performance page or a journal in the press flow, that will never run. And if you have normal page caching enabled, then the hook underscore commit function will never run. So that's kind of ways that you can sort of tune and you know, get your site to operate a little bit. So yeah, awful lot of overhead, but you just do what you can. Next. That's one way to do it, sure. You want to be careful when you're telling it to run first, right? Because you never want it to really run or never run before core. But there are some modules that you just don't want it to run before. The best practice is to create a .install file and then just set the way on the install. And you'll hook it up. That's just the best way. You can do it that way. I don't know this offhand. Is there an API function set weight? Anybody know? No? Good for query. So if it's update system set weight equals 5 or name equals module. that's one of those situations where you definitely don't want things running before certain core things, otherwise it's all stuff of behavior and just those functions. Yes. Right. That's right. Yep. It's actually a statement. There's a hook in Drupal 7 that actually allows you to rearrange the weights. So that's another way you can do it. If you don't want to do it on install, and you like, actually the best practice for that would be if I built a module and I want to affect the weight of another module, I probably wouldn't update its system table. I would probably do that. Alright, a little short, but I just wanted to kind of give a high level of Drupal. Thank you very much. Enjoy the rest of the conference.